Hallelujah. Thank you for your power. Thank you, Jesus. today that you won't pass us by. Do not pass us by. Come on, somebody needs to tell the Lord, do not pass me by. Do not pass me by. Thank you, Lord.
I'm not going to jump in flips and circles. But every time I get an opportunity to speak, preach, a.k.a. speak, on Sunday mornings, I always say, I'm not going to be before you long. Right?
Yeah.
I say, I'm going to give you a quick word. I say, we're going to be in and out. But not today.
Hey!
I can't even say that with a straight face. Not today. Some of y'all ready to get y'all purses and walk out before you run out. As I said, the Lord gave me something to share with you. He gave me so much. Somebody say, so much.
Oh, yeah.
I am prepared to preach the longest message I've ever preached in Agape history. See, she's cheering me on because she knows I don't do that. Now, some of y'all don't believe me, but I'm not talking about in length. Just, it's okay, you're going to be okay. Look at somebody and say, we're going to be all right.
We're going to be all right.
But we are going to talk about one of the most longest topics that the Bible mentions in the Bible, and it is going to be pursuing God's righteous judgment. It is one of the most described topics in the Bible. It also has the longest chapter in the Bible is dedicated to talking about righteous judgment. Who wants to take a stab at that chapter, the longest chapter in the Bible? Biblical trivia here. Anybody want to take a stab at it? Psalm 119, and we're going to go into that today. It's simply the message on seeking good judgment. Somebody say, seeking good judgment.
Seeking good judgment.
This concept is mentioned in the Bible when you see the words judgment, precepts, statutes, laws, wisdom. It even talks about the foolish. Yes, the Bible says it calls some people fools. Self-control, commandments, and righteousness. Anytime you see these words in the Bible, you better be certain that the writer is talking about righteous judgment. So, it's the longest message in the Bible because it's the most talked about message in the Bible. And I said, you can all put your purses down. I'm not going to be before you long. One man is known by turning the tables in time in his first public request to the Lord. And we're going to start there in 1 Kings 3:9. 1 Kings 3:9 is where Solomon was a child and he inherited a kingdom. And God told Solomon, ask anything you want and I'll give it to you. And this is what Solomon said. In the complete Jewish Bible, it says it like this. Solomon said, therefore, let's read it together in the complete Jewish Bible up here. Therefore, give your an understanding able to administer
justice
to your people so that I can
discern
between
good and bad.
For who is to judging the great people of yours? The New Living Version, I'll read this one. Give me an understanding heart that I can govern your people well. And know the difference between right and wrong. For who by himself is able to govern this great people of ours? Now I know we're all adults, okay? So we all know how to do some things. But I'm talking about, even as adults, we've got to ask for God's counsel in our lives. Let's read the Amplified together. So give your an understanding and a hearing to judge your
people,
that I may
discern
between
good and bad.
For who is able
to judge
and rule this great people? And lastly, we're going to read it in the Message Bible. He says, here's what I want. Give me a God-listening heart. Somebody say, God-listening heart.
God-listening.
So that I can lead your people well, discerning the difference between good and evil. For who on their own is capable of leading your glorious people? 1 Kings 3 and 9. Some people ask for all these other gifts. Solomon could have asked for money. Solomon could have asked for women. Solomon could have asked for riches. But he asked for God's wisdom. And we're going to talk about that. And when we ask for God's wisdom, we will never be late to our destiny appointment. Now, why do we need God's wisdom? Because things aren't as they appear. Have you ever been tricked? You bought something and you thought it was all this. You know? Sister, you was not duped with that. Because it absolutely looks fabulous on you. She said, have you ever been duped and then all of a sudden you get real close and you start seeing the detail? I buy stuff all the time online and it don't fit right as it appears online. Yeah. Bishop had an anniversary and I was so careful to buy this absolutely fabulous dress on eBay. It had tassels. It was wonderful. And then I got it and it was plastic. It was a plastic dress. Now who wears it? It didn't say it was plastic, but I found out when I got it and I opened up the box. This is one of the seven wonders of the world. If you're not familiar, this is the Rock of Gibraltar. This is a major place. It's a city, and you can climb up the mountain, you can drive up the mountain, and it is major. Tourists go to Spain all the time to see the Rock of Gibraltar. But unless you know better, you'll get there and be surprised. Because the Rock of Gibraltar is full of aggressive monkeys that likes to jump on people's heads. So, you tell me, is this one of your little tourist spots? Absolutely not. Because it's going to take one monkey to jump over my head. And I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to be monkey against monkey. Because we're going to have a problem. You don't know that, though. Because you don't see that from the rock. And so my point is, we need God's discernment. Even while going on vacation. She's smiling, but I'm telling you, she ain't happy. Apostle told us about the Rock of Gibraltar, how he took Pastor Rudolph. And when you get on the island, they have signs up that says, we have native monkeys and you cannot hit them. You have to let them do whatever they want. And you cannot take your camera out, because if you take your camera out, they will jump down, snatch it, and run up in the trees. Y'all keep Gibraltar. I'll go to Fiesta. I'll be good. See, the problem is not whether the devil fights us at church or whether we can hear God in the sanctuary. The issue is when we are going about on our day-to-day lives, can we hear the Spirit when we're about to pray over price for something? What the Lord tells you about over price? Girl, please, if you don't know, come talk to me afterwards. I ain't got the time right now. The issue is, can we... My head auntie know about that. Can we hear God when we have heard a medical determination from a doctor involving our body that's contrary to the word of God? Have you ever had a doctor look at you and say, there is something wrong with you? We've got to be able to hear God even over what they're saying. Discern when someone is in our life for good or for bad. We learn from this scripture that God gave Solomon jurisdiction over something that he could not directly decipher on his own. God did this on purpose to see if Solomon would turn to the Lord with the success of his new assignment. God doesn't expect you to figure it out on your own. No, he doesn't. He knows that every time man's hand gets in it, it stinks. Come on, God knows that. Anything you are trying to figure out, God has already worked out. He doesn't expect you to just know that you should make a decision or not. He expects you to see the size of the assignment that he's given you and then come back to him for help to make that assignment succeed. This is where we are going to go into Psalm 119, longest chapter in the Bible.
We're going to read.
This is where David begins to write a short story on possessing good judgment, and it is the longest chapter in the Bible. And if you read this chapter, God helps you tune your instrument. So, I got 3 points for you on how to seek God's guidance in your life. Are you ready? 3 points. That's it. Longest message in the Bible. Longest message in the Bible. 3 points. Number one, ask God to keep you on course, on the course that he mapped out for you. I'm going to say it again. Ask God to keep you on the course that he mapped out for you. And the third time, we're all going to say it together. Ask God to keep you on the course that he mapped out for you. In Psalm 119 and 1, it says, you are blessed when you stay on course. This is the Message Bible. When you walk steadily on the road God has revealed. Psalm 119 and 5 says, oh, that my steps will be what?
Steady.
Thank you. Oh, that my steps will be steady, keeping to the course that you have set. Then I never have any regrets in comparing my life with your counsel. Has anybody ever felt regret before? Have you ever felt regret? I mean, you know, it's just the little things. I went to a vacation in Mexico, and I saw these Aladdin pants. I'm telling you, these pants were magical. They had them in every color, every pattern. And I'm looking at them like, how that gonna look on me? Now, they don't have dressing rooms on the ports of Mexico, okay? So for all y'all solo serves and Diddy, JCPenney's, I need a dressing room. Where's the lady? It's dirty in here. No. You just look at them, and then it said one size fits all. Said it wasn't true. So I looked at them Aladdin pants. I looked back at them. I said, golly, I got to get one of these. I got to. So I got one of them. I got on the boat, and I loved them. They are the most comfortable, best pants I have ever bought. Now, I started regretting that I didn't buy every color. Some of y'all have regrets about real serious things. It's just for me, it's just pretty. You know, the devil, he tried to do anything. And I'm like, all the rest of the day, I was like, oh. So I said, next time I go to Mexico, y'all will see them pants. I'm coming here every week with them pants on. I love them pants. You don't have to live with regret if you follow in the course that God set for you. Nothing that you live isn't a wrong answer when you are following the course that God has set for you. Psalm 119 and 33 says, God, teach me lessons for living so I can stay the course. I could go on and on. Psalm 119 and 110 says, the wicked do their best to throw me off track, but I do not swerve an inch from your course. God has a course. You know what that means? God has a plan. It's a perfect plan for your life. And if you ask God to keep you on course, he'll do it. Now in Ephesians 1 and Romans 8, God hints at the notion that our lives are predestined. And some people don't get this concept, so I'm going to break it down for you. This does not mean that God has already mapped out my road to sin. No. What this means is, God has already mapped out our road to success. It's a success roadmap. It is then our choice to keep on the course that God has set out for us without detours, U-turns, or unnecessary delays. Now, we know this concept. We do this all the time. Or some people do this all the time. Direction assistance, aka GPS, is right in our phones. Whether you use that function, it's in your phone. And some people say, I didn't want an iPhone. phone because I didn't want people to know where I was exactly at all times. And I knew that the iPhone had this tracker in it. And then somebody tapped me on the shoulder and they said, do you have GPS in your Nokia? And I said, yes. They said, people know where you are at all times. Okay, GPS, that's what it is, right? They're giving you directions from point A to point B. Even if you don't have GPS, you might have asked someone for directions at one point in your life. Anybody ever asked for directions? Amen. The point is, whether you use GPS, directions, or map, you all acknowledge that at that moment, you don't know how to get to the destination. Does everybody understand that? You don't know how to get. Now, you might have, because if you knew how to get there, you wouldn't need directions. You would need GPS. And sometimes GPS take you all around the bend. Me and Bishop, when we bought the house, we had to go to the design center. And it was somewhere on Stone Oak somewhere. And I had just gotten my little iPhone. And I said, Mama, the iPhone don't never lie. You know, I was just telling her all this stuff. The iPhone don't lie. The iPhone don't lie. So I put it in. GPS took us to a dead end somewhere. I turned around and said, okay, Mama, could you call them and get us some directions? Because the iPad done lied. Said the thing done lied on me. You gotta be careful. Ephesians 1:17-18 says, God, make my eyes focused and clear on the path that you've called me to do. When I played basketball, I didn't like looking at the other team. Why? Because I didn't want to be intimidated by the other team. I was the tallest girl on the team, so that meant I had to face the tallest girls on the other team. And I remember we went to, we played Tyvee. I don't even know what city they from. Tyvee. These girls, they had a set of twins that was 6'6". And I remember looking at them saying, early? Myself, I just went to coach. I said, look, I'm gonna do the best I can do today, okay? I don't want to hear you saying rebound. I'm gonna just get whatever I can get. Because I didn't want to be, that's why I didn't want to look at her, because I didn't want to be intimidated. This is a biblical concept, if you knew it or not. Luke 21 and 26 says that people's hearts will melt when they see what will come on the earth. People are getting fearful by just looking at the news. Sometimes we lose track of the course because the opposing team looks intimidating. Oh my gosh. Other times we lose track because we're comparing our family with somebody else's family. We're comparing our job with somebody else's job. Our life with somebody else's life. And we know what the Bible says about comparison, right? To compare yourself among yourself is not wise. Somebody say, to compare yourself among yourself is not wise, which means it's not smart for me to compare myself to you. Compare my kids to your kids. Compare my grandkids to your grandkids. Compare my job to you. Compare my hair to yours. Trust me. Trust me. I learned this a long time ago. Women have different courses of hair. Yesterday, scrolling, and this girl was talking about this beautiful natural product. Oh, it works well on natural girls' hair, and oh, it just makes you look so wonderful. And you know, I was buying it until I thought about it. I looked at her, then I looked at her hair, and then I said, she's probably from Ethiopia. It didn't work on you. It wasn't right. Shampoo, it looked cute on the in the store. Oh, it's got a jojoba oil. Oh, Moroccan. That's got to. I know what my hair like. You don't know nothing about your hair. can't be comparing ourselves. Look at somebody and say, stop comparing yourself.
Stop comparing yourself.
God's not lining us up like these cats. Now you can't see it, it's a little blurred, but this one on this side is the lion, okay? Then the next one is the tiger. Then we got the mountain lion, then we got the cheetah, all the way down to the you know, they are similar, but they are very different. There was a video on YouTube the other day where this man was on a safari, in an open African safari, in an open Jeep, riding through slowly looking at cheetahs. Did anybody see this clip?
Yes.
And the cheetah jumped from several yards away through the sunroof of the Jeep behind and sat in the back seat. Excuse me. What are you doing on an African safari with the windows down with the sunroof open? Is this just me or am I just... So what he did was the tour guide said, do not make any sudden moves. Don't look in its face. If you look at him, it'll feel like it's threatened and it'll attack you. So the guy raised up his cell phone and started recording. And the cheetah was just like smelling everything. He was looking at him. Come on now. Oh, this is a cheetah. This ain't a lion. The cheetahs don't, you better stop. Cheetahs is the fastest animals out there. The fastest. Ask God to keep you on the course. Ask God to keep you on the course. We know that if God keeps you on the course, the race isn't given to the swift or the battle to the strong. We have seen many victories won in the Bible by the underdog, the small army, the least likely to succeed. So my humble advice is this, stay the course. Stay on course. Look at somebody and say, stay on course. Number two, ask God to steady your steps. Staying on the course is different than steadying your steps. It doesn't matter how cute you look, how much your clothes cost, how many compliments you receive in a day. If you can't, keep your balance. You can have a big house, a big car, great marriage, great family support, good job, but if you cannot enjoy it because of poor balance or poor judgment, it's not even worth having. I'm not saying that you don't know how to walk uprightly before God or in the natural. I'm not saying that you don't know how to read your Bible or that God doesn't speak to you. All I'm saying is that ask God to help you stand up straight in Him. Ask God to keep your eyes focused on Him. Before you run out and report me to Bishop, all I'm asking is that you ask God to keep your feet firm on the Word of God. Just like children have to learn to walk upright, Pastor tells that story, that little Shekinah was 1 year old, Joshua was like 10 months and he started walking. I mean, Joshua always wanted to be ahead. He always wanted to be out in front. Well, she kind of turned 1 year old and she was crawling. She did not walk, didn't want, we would pick her up, she'd fall. We did that so many times, it was just getting ridiculous. She was almost a year and a half. Now, during this time, she was also battling a condition with her eye. Her eye was swollen and so she had poor vision in one eye. So we were trying to think, is this eye related? Is this vision related? What's going on? And so Stephanie took her to one of her checkups and she said, doctor, what's wrong with her? She won't walk. Is there something wrong with her legs, doctor? Is there something wrong with her knees, doctor? Is there something wrong with her? And the doctor said, there is something wrong with her. She's like, oh, thank you. I'm glad somebody's finally going, what is it? And he said, she is, like, waiting for this scientific term, and he said, she's lazy. This little girl is lazy. My baby? What? He said, if you keep picking them up and you don't make them walk, they get lazy. So guess what Shekinah got when she got home. A rude awakening. Now, you get up on your own. There's a chair, you're gonna start walking. And guess what? She started walking. These kids like talking about when they were babies. The Bible says if you waver to the right or to the left, you are double-minded in all your ways. Anybody ever fail when you was trying to walk with heels? Well, you may not be sure about everything in your life. All I'm saying is be sure about what God says. Don't believe everything, but definitely believe God. Definitely believe the word of God. Walking uprightly means walking without reproach. Now, another way of saying this is, Lord, remove all distractions from my path and order my steps in your word. Order my steps in your word. One thing you can pray is, Lord, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. The entrance of your word brings light, and I say it also brings life. Come on, distractions try to come to cause you to forget about what to focus on. I'm just saying that you should ask God to steady your path as you're climbing the corporate ladder, strengthen your character as you embark on a new relationship, and increase your faith as you launch out into the deep. Somebody say, Lord, steady my steps in your word. And number three, number one, we said was lead me on the course that you have set for me. Number two, cause me to be firm in my belief. Cause me to be firm in who I know God is. Things are not always easy in what God says. Number three, final point. Ask God to reveal any hidden dangers on your path and foil the plan of the enemy. Do you know that the enemy sets traps for us and you have the power to ask God to cancel every one of those assignments? It doesn't. We used to live next to a cooling dove. She worked all kinds of sorceries. She was a book of that. And because of what she was doing in her backyard, we had rats and all kinds of stuff in our house. She was sacrificing and doing all kinds of stuff in her backyard. She had a little house. She did. One time she invited us out there too. You know, Bishop was fearless. You think Bishop was something today. She just... She went in that little house. Blood of Jesus against that. What she did know, that lady was trying to brag about her little sanctuary. But Bishop went in there canceling just buying that. I mean, she was, she shouldn't have invited her in there. I'm just saying. The Bible says, if not for the Lord on our side, we would have been swallowed up whole by the entrapments of the enemy. Think about how many times that God brought you out of a very ugly situation. You know, you don't have to be on drugs in order for you to be in an ugly situation.
Amen.
You don't have to be a drunkard before you have an ugly situation. Sometimes family situations just get sticky and ugly. And then the people that's closest to you, then the people that call that, you know, they act like they with you. And sometimes those situations, you didn't ask for, you didn't want to be there, and there God is in the middle of the situation rescuing you out of a trap. Psalm 91 says, he delivers us from the snare of the fowler. In other words, the enemy sets a trap for us every day. However, if you know the enemy is trying to trap you every day, you should go out of your house ready, prepared with the full armor of God, as it says in Ephesians 6:10. Because the enemy has no power over the power of God. Now, Paul said, I will not have you ignorant of Satan's devices in 2 Corinthians 2 and 11. The enemy doesn't like it when we walk on course. The enemy doesn't like it when our steps are firm and our faith is firm in God. And he certainly doesn't like it when we're standing upright in God. However, God keeps us from dangers that we see and from dangers that we don't see. So that tells me that God's power is stronger than the power of the enemy. Now, just yesterday, there was a fire in a high-rise building. Everybody saw that in New York. There was a fire in an apartment/business building, and it was a 58-story building. There were people that were living in the building at the time of the fire. The fire happened on the 30-something floor, and an elderly couple was on the 36th floor. Elderly couple on the 36th floor. Elderly couple on the 36th floor, and the man has Parkinson's disease. So the lady said she didn't even know that there was a fire until she called the front desk. And watch this. No, she saw it on the news. And then she started calling the front desk, but guess who she got when she called down there? Nobody, because the fireman had come in and evacuated the front desk. So they were on the 38th floor hearing about a fire. I think it was on the 36th floor. There's some stuff we need good judgment on. We need God's judgment to discern and determine. If you forget being, and this couple was 71. A fire on the 30-something floor, if it had not been contained, ain't no getting out if you're 71. I mean, it don't take a rocket science to get that. They were talking about the Twin Towers at 9/11.
Stairs?
How many flights of stairs can you run down before you pass out? We need God's judgment. We need good judgment. The Bible says all things are lawful, but everything ain't expedient. Everything ain't smart. And when you have these type of situations, you need God to step in. You ain't getting me to sign no lease to be on the 58th floor. I'm sorry. Ain't doing it. And the building don't have sprinklers. Because it's too old. So they had to get the fireman, had to shut the elevators down, run up 36 floors to put out a fire that they couldn't, that there were no automatic sprinklers on. We need God's judgment. You looking to move, you looking to do bigger things, we need God's judgment. Because I'm telling you right now, actually the other day I was at the courthouse and the elevators wasn't working. I had to go up to the 5th floor. So I said, this is just, I got this. I ran in heels. I don't know how, what I done got on. In heels, I ran up 1st floor to the 2nd floor. 2nd floor to the 3rd floor. I got to the top of the 3rd floor. I seen a friend in the hallway. She's like, hey, Shekinah. I said, 1 second. 1 second. How you doing? I got up to the 4th floor, and by that time I was like, Jesus, fix it. I know I'm gonna make it, but got up to the 5th floor, and guess what? The door at the 5th floor was locked. I'm shaking it. I'm like, oh no! I'm beating on the door. Hello? Hola? They didn't open that door. Wherever that door went, it was not available. I walked down to the 4th floor. I said, somebody gonna pay for this. 4 floors. That was enough for me. Then I went to the elevator and it was free. I said, now, come on now. This is ridiculous. Ask God to reveal the dangers on the path. God keeps us from the snare of the fowler. God is not afraid of the enemy. Somebody say, God is not afraid of the enemy.
God is not afraid of the enemy.
He told Peter, Satan wants to sift you as wheat. But he didn't leave Peter there. He said, don't worry, because I have overcome the world. In other words, that's how I save the world. They got t-shirts out with this. I absolutely love it. I got to give you one. That's how I save the world. That's what Jesus said. He told David that even if you walk in the valley of the shadow of death, you do not have to fear because you are not alone. Somebody said, he is with me. This is powerful because God didn't remove the valley from our course, but he promised to be there with us in the valley. Somebody said, he is with us. The enemy tries to harm us, but it cannot prosper against us because God is with us. What did he say in the Lord's Prayer and we're almost done? He said, pray on this wise, lead me not into temptation, but deliver me from evil. In other words, show me where the potholes are in my life. Show me where the glass is so I don't step on it and hurt myself. Show me which multiple choice answer to do because I don't know the answer. You have to be honest with yourself and tell God you don't know the next step, but I trust you to deliver me from evil. Deuteronomy 29 and 29 says this, the secret things belong to the Lord, but those things that are revealed, they belong, somebody say, unto me. Can you be honest with yourself that you don't have it all together? Can you be honest with yourself that you don't know how to pay off everything at the same time? You don't know who you're going to marry. You don't know when your next promotion is. You don't know if you're going to be switching jobs. You don't know how long your car, you're going to be with your same car. Some of y'all, you don't know when you going to wash your car. I mean, let's be simple. Let's be honest. Okay? I was heckling Bishop about her car. I said, Bishop, you drive a Cadillac. This cannot be dirty. And then I bumped up against my own car, and it was just, I mean, it just messed up my pants. I was like, this car is terribly dirty. Sweep around your own front door before you try to sweep around hers, Elder.
She
can't
hear
me, but she knows. Some of y'all, you don't know how many children you're going to have. Well, wait a minute. Some of y'all do. You don't know how many grandkids you're going to have. This is things that you just don't know. Time to say, yes, I do. Yes, I do. These are facts that are unknown to us, but they are known to God. Somebody said, God knows. It does not yet appear what we shall be, but every time he appears, we are more and more like him. Number one, ask God to keep you on course. Number two, ask God to steady your steps. Cause me to be firm and grounded in who I know God is. And number three, Lord, reveal the traps of the enemy and foil every plan of the enemy. You don't have to walk around afraid. You don't have to walk around afraid.
Hallelujah.
Every time you look at me, everybody look at you. Just fraidy cat, they used to call them. Fraidy cats. You don't have to do that. God can give you insight on what to do and when to do it, and that will help you be confident in what the next step is.
We've got to be wise
and seek God's wisdom on our daily decisions. So I'm telling you, whatever it is that has you up in the middle of the night, whatever it is that takes up your joy time, whatever it is that's bringing down your happy moments, because God wants us to be happy. He ain't the one putting sadness in our path, just letting us, well, just deal with it. No. I'm going to laugh at every situation, every one of them.